your name. We magnify your name.
We magnify your name.
We magnify your name.
Oh, we lift your high. We lift your high.
We magnify your name. We magnify your name.
Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord.
You are magnified. You are magnified. You are the God of the impossible. What you did yesterday, you will do today. Now Spirit, I need you. Come, sweet Spirit, I pray. Won't you come in your strength and your power? Come in your own special ways.
Lord God, come.
Come, Holy Spirit. We're waiting on you. We're waiting on you, Lord. We're waiting on you. Come and have your way. Come and have your way, Lord. Come and have your way. Come and have your way. Hallelujah.
Yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil. For you are with me. Your rod and your staff, they comfort me. Even though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, your perfect love is casting out fear. Even though I'm stuck in the middle of the storms of this life, I won't turn back, I know you are near, and I will fear no evil, for my God is with me. And if my God is with me, whom then shall I fear? Whom then shall I fear?
let go.
Thank you, Jesus.
Thank you, Jesus.
Hallelujah.
You know, there's an old song we used to sing. I think some of you might remember. In times like these, you need an anchor. In times like these, you need a savior. Be very sure, so very sure, your anchor holds and grips the solid. You know, a little bit over a year ago, both Marie and I lost our moms within a 6-day period of each other. And that was a trying time. And to watch these godly women deteriorate. I was there with my mom. Marie was with her mom. We weren't there, couldn't be there for each other. But as we gathered around my mom, the one thing that seemed to perk her up each time was when we worshiped. Until she left this earth, she heard her children worshiping. That seemed to give her strength for the next moment. And sometimes that's what gets us through. When we're down, when we're feeling like we're drugged through the mud, when the waves are hitting you and the wind is beating against you, worship. Because he inhabits the praise of his people. And when he is lifted up, he strengthens us. I'm gonna sing till my heart starts changing. I'm gonna worship till I mean every word. Cause the way I feel and the fear I'm facing doesn't change who you are or what you deserve. I give you my worship. You still deserve it. You're worthy, you're worthy, you're worthy of my song. I pour out my praises in blessing and breaking. You're worthy, you're worthy, you're worthy of my song.
Gonna preach to my soul like you already won. And even though I can't see it, I'm gonna keep believing that every promise you made is as good as done. Oh,
I give you my worship. You still deserve it. You're worthy of my soul. I pour out my praises.
worthy. When I sat by that hospital bed, you were worthy.
Yes. Hallelujah.
And she could barely lift her head, you were worthy. After all those tears we shed, you were worthy. I'll never stop singing your praise. I'll never stop singing your praise. And in the blessing and the pain, you are worthy. You are worthy.
Thank you.
God, we just thank you tonight that you are worthy. That regardless of what we're facing, regardless of what we feel, that you are worthy. I just thank you tonight for that reminder, for the words of that song. That Lord Jesus, whatever it is that we're facing, whatever it is that we're up against, that you are worthy and that you are the answer. That you are the one that gives us life, that you are the beginning and the end. Lord Jesus, I thank you tonight that as we do come together in worship, as we come together to recognize who you are, that there would just be a correction that would come in any place in our life where it needs to be. That there would be an alignment that would take place. That we would see your spirit, that we would be led by your spirit, that your spirit would be the only thing guiding us and leading us, that we would see and know. That we only see in part, but in you, Lord Jesus. Through your spirit, we have the ability to transcend our earthly limitations and to be able to say yes. Lord Jesus, we want to be led by you. We recognize your power. We recognize who you are as the King. And tonight, Lord Jesus, we just say thank you. Thank you that we can be here together tonight. Thank you that we can look to you. Lord Jesus, we love you. We worship you tonight. And we do exalt your name. Because you are worthy. You are worthy of it all. And we just tell you tonight that we love you and we praise you. In Jesus' name we pray. And we all said, amen. 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 Let's just tell them one more time how much we love them tonight, church. Lord Jesus, we just thank you tonight. Worship team, thank you so much. I really do love that song. No matter what's going on, he's worthy. Never stop singing. I want to ask if you would just turn around, give somebody a hug, tell them how happy you are to see them here tonight. Welcome everybody who's watching online. We're so grateful that you are here with us. I want to ask if our ushers would come forward tonight. We're going to take up our offering, and then we have a few announcements that we're going to make here this evening. As we do this, I just want to gather together and just to remember what it is that we're doing as we give our tithes and our offerings, as we just look to him and we say, thank you, Jesus, for the ability to be able to pour back into your kingdom. So I want to ask if you would just close your eyes with me one more time. Father God, I just thank you for the opportunity that we have tonight to pour into your kingdom, to take what you have entrusted to us. That we take what you have given to us and we choose to trust you with it, because you, Lord God, you are the source, you are our Savior, you are our provider, and we just say thank you for the ability to partner together with you in everything that you're doing in this time. In Jesus' name we pray, and we all said amen, amen. You can pass the buckets. Thank you so much. So tonight, I just wanted to make a couple of announcements before we get started here. The first announcement is I just wanted to thank everyone who played a part in our Labor Day picnic. It was such an amazing time. I know that Melissa Dibelbus had a huge part in it. We had a lot of people who were involved, Ethel in the kitchen, and we're just so grateful for everyone that comes together in those moments and can bring these things together to spend this time together in community. The next thing that I want to announce is that next week we have our Royal Rangers and our girls ministries that are coming back. So that's coming back next week, which is awesome. Miss Tuttle's in the back leading our girls' ministries. So excited about that. Which means that when you come with your kids, anyone watching online thinking, I can't come because I have no one to watch my kids. Guess what? You have no more excuses. You got to come back. We have place for your kids to learn and to grow and to be a part of these awesome ministries. Two more things. If anyone is participating in the Harvest Fest at the end of October, we have a training that's taking place at Fishkill Baptist. That's going to be this Saturday at 10 a.m. So if you want to take place in the amazing outreach that's going to take place in October, come out to this training. They're going to teach you and show you all the things that we really need to know in order to make this happen. And the last one for tonight is that we have a couples barbecue for married couples on September 24th. That's going to be at 1 o'clock. So if anyone is interested in that, you can let the church know or sign up after the service on Sunday. And last but not least, we have our Connect classes coming up this Sunday, Connect Class A, so that's coming back. So at this time, I want to invite my brother Christian up here. So excited anytime that he gets to share. He's done an awesome job in doing a lot of the transitions and stuff. I was gone this last week, and I love going away knowing that we have some amazing pastoral staff to cover everything when I'm gone, and just really excited for the word that's on your heart tonight.
Thank you so much. You guys hear me? We're all good? Woohoo! Well, I'm back again, and I'm very happy to be back again. Welcome to church, guys. I have an idea of what I'm talking about tonight. Actually, I have a long, long list of ideas. My method is often prepare as much as possible and see where I get, because Holy Spirit just kind of does what he wants. I've had times of preaching in, we had a home church for 12 years, and I've had times of preaching at the home church with, you know, a group of 25 people, and there'd be days where I had a full long list of things, and in worship, God just kind of just whoop, cut me up from under me, and I just like cried for the first 10 minutes. And I think there's something about having an authentic heart and desiring after the things of God and giving him a lot of space to work, that he does things that don't necessarily make sense and does things that aren't always the most polished. But when you give him these opportunities, he ends up using the foolish things, like a person's tears, to confound the wise. And there's a lot of mystery in God, and I'm very happy and grateful to be up here and to convey some of those mysteries that I just feel like the Lord's put on my heart. And all that to say, this is one such moment where I have a lot to say, and we're going to see where I'm going to get to, but just during worship, I just felt like this deluge. And I don't know if it's because I've only eaten like a granola bar today. You know, it's one of those things. Fasting is a very interesting and mystical experience. I don't know who's ever been on like a long fast. You know, it's a weird mix. You don't necessarily know where your delirium from your body not having food ended and where Holy Spirit took over and began. And sometimes it's somewhere in between, and he just likes to utilize those things. And all that to say is I really feel like the Lord wants to do something awesome tonight. And I don't want to say that as in he doesn't want to do something all the time. But I really believe that there's something really powerful tonight that he wants to do. And I just felt, and this is going to be a little weird, but I just felt like when I was worshiping, he put on my heart this phrase, to wait on him. Like, to wait, he said, wait on me. And I can feel the tears already. Like, wait on me. And I feel like that's a word that can be timely, because, man, our whole reality as humans is we're waiting on the Lord. It is, you know? We're waiting on the ultimate truth of his son returning. We're waiting on either an answer we need, and we're asking and we're desiring, and it's like sometimes it doesn't feel as reassuring as it could be, but it's one of the most reassuring things when he's like, just wait on me. Because there's something about waiting on the Lord that doesn't diminish us. It's actually meant to strengthen us. It's made to build us up. Does anyone feel in this room like you're in a waiting season? Anyone in here, raise your hand. Before we end, I want to pray over that, because I feel like the grace of the Lord wants to be on you, that you wouldn't feel diminished, that you would feel empowered, that you feel built up. Thank you. And it's like, it's special. We live in a special time. We're finite humans waiting for eternity to come, and we don't get this time back, you know? We won't be waiting forever. We won't be, you know, imperfect forever. We won't be, you know, physically deteriorating forever. At some point, we will be in the completeness, that seventh-day rest that we were all supposed to have before Adam and Eve. One day, we're going to be in that. But right now, we're in this very special time where we don't have, you know, we have a choice whether we can trust in God or not. We have a choice whether we're going to rely on him and lay our weight on him or not. We have a choice whether, you know, we don't know what's going to happen next. And we have a choice in the sorrow and in the pain and maybe the questions of our soul and the places where we don't know where to go, we don't know which place to go, we don't know what to do with our pain. And there's a place that I like what Bill Johnson said. He said it recently with the passing of his wife, that you don't get this time back. You don't get the time of not knowing and being imperfect and being finite back. And I fully believe that what we do in those moments where we're not sure what's happening and we don't have all the answers and we're waiting on God and we're like, whether it's for a miracle, whether it's for something that's like someone's life that we're waiting for, we're waiting for God to do something, or it's the answer to a job, or it's, you know, it's our finances, or it's like a deep place of prayer. We don't know. And let's not waste that time. Let's not waste the time in the pain. Let's not waste the time in the unknowing. Because God wants to strengthen us in that. And I think he's going to strengthen us. And so this is for a message, whoever's out there. He's going to strengthen you in the times of the waiting and the pain for the next place that you're going to walk into. And there's something is going to come out of that. He was whispering to me. He's like, the tears of this season are going to water the orchards of the next season. And that is something important for us. And as you see when I start talking about what I start talking about, that has nothing to do with it, but it's a timeless message. And I think there's going to be times in heaven where we look back on the complete mess that is human existence, and we see the places where we chose to trust in the Lord and in the fullness of him. And that's going to sing brighter than any place of surety. It's going to be bright. And I believe, sometimes I believe just that these are eternal moments in the places of hardship. So if that's anyone in here, I don't know why I specifically am feeling this, but if that's anyone in here, I want to reassure you that something amazing is going to come out of that. And if there's anyone in here waiting, and if there's any place of grief, I also want to pray for that. That God wants to heal your grief. And I know that sounds like, oh, he wants to take away your grief. I think sometimes when we enter into the place of recovery and the healing of the soul through grief, the answer is not that I'd feel better. The answer is that he's there with me. And that's a strange concept. It's a strange concept to feel like God is with me and my pain is still here and I still hold the two things in tension. And there's something that is meant to be birthed out of that. And so, you know, I just want to do this because he said to wait on him. So I'm going to just take this moment. If we could all just be in this place. I don't know what people's life is like right now. I don't know what season you just came out of. I don't know what season you're going into. But I feel like this is a specific moment where the Lord just wants us to wait on him for even just a few seconds. And as you hold, like, your life in front of you and you're just like, Lord, what are you doing in this time? Whether it's really hard or if it's just a place of wondering, I just feel like the Holy Spirit wants to drop even the most subtle hint. So if we could just wait and just close your eyes and just be with him for a second or two. Spirit, I thank you for your grace. I thank you that waiting for you is the greatest privilege we could ever have. You're good, Jesus. I'm talking about image tonight, and excuse me for a second. Talking about image tonight, and specifically our philosophy on image. Image is one of those things that I think when we grow up and we grow up in church that and we either listen to a youth pastor or we listen to like Sunday school, we kind of think of image and being made in the image of God and you know, partaking in that as really thinking of our anatomical body. We kind of like, we give people advice when we feel like they don't have enough confidence and we're like, oh, you're made in the image of God. You should, you know, you look at yourself in the mirror and every time you're in the mirror, you should see that you're a son or daughter of God. And I think sometimes that notion has diminished the real impact of what it means to be made in the image of God. And it's not just about the way we look. It's about our entire existence. Our entire existence, our entire reality, everything that we are is because we are made in the image of God. And what that image means is more than maybe just looking a specific way. It's about everything inside of us, the way we are wired, the way we operate in the world, is made in that intangible, heaven-like substance that is eternal. And it's about having the attributes of God. It's about walking in a way and in a lifestyle of understanding who your Father is, understanding what the truth is, having that deep, deep sense that God is not only with you and operating in you, but He designed you to operate in a specific way. And it's more than how you look, it's how you are. It's how you exist, is that you are the image of God. And I want to talk about philosophy. I have a heart for philosophy. I have a heart for theology. I have a heart for thinking. I have a heart for the weightier, more intricate parts of doctrine, more intricate parts of how the world works, of truth, of all the big words like epistemology and ecclesiology and, you know, all these things. I love them. And that's my heart. And my heart is to express those things in a way that the body of Christ can take them and for what they were always meant to be. And the concept of philosophy is that God created our minds, and our minds are meant to operate in a way where we see the things of God, and we know the things of God, and we reason the things of God, and out of that comes how we live our lives. It's the Romans 12 saying that if you're renewed in your mind, you'll be transformed, and you'll be able to decipher what the will of God is. And I believe, and I love what Pastor Dave talked about a few weeks ago, that spiritual maturity, I believe spiritual maturity is obviously what we're busy with for our entire life before we get to the throne room of God at the end of all things. It's the spiritual maturity. But I fully believe that spiritual maturity only comes through the transforming of our minds and the theological formation that occurs when we spend time in God's word, we spend time in His presence, and we allow truth to be reflected on us and then reflect out. In scientific terms, there is no image like your vision. There is no vision without light. That's one of the simplest things, that the only reason I can see you and you can see me is because some source of light is shining and then filling the entirety of the room. This exists in this small room, and it exists when God said, let there be light. Why did He say, let there be light? There's the nature that He created everything, and what good is it if you can't see it? Light is something that when it shines, it illuminates what it shines. And the cool part is that our image only exists as a reflection of the source. Our image, who we are, does not exist opposite or against or without the source of the light that is our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. And we see an issue with life is that people have cut themselves off from the source, and thus their image has begun to deteriorate. And those same people influence other people, and they cut themselves off from the light, and the light deteriorates. It's that Luke 11, why would you light a light and hide it under a bushel? That is what is happening with the world around us. There is that light, that is that concept of having the imago Dei, having the image of God, that light that was meant to be reflected from the King and then reflected out is being put under a bushel, and eventually it goes out. And that's something that, unfortunately, I see Christians doing the same thing. We are meant to reflect. We are meant to reflect that heavenly light. The Bible has it loves that word light. It uses it for everything. It uses it for truth. It uses it for revelation. It uses it for physical seeing. But it also uses it as a way of saying that God's very essence is supposed to shine on you and supposed to reflect outwards. And that's how you know who you are. You know who you are only in relation to the King. You don't know yourself opposite of the King. Does that make sense? I thank God that I have the Holy Spirit, because He makes me make sense. I have this quote here. If you could throw it on there. I saw it and I was like, this makes total sense. The Holy Spirit turns biblical concepts into experienced realities. The Holy Spirit takes words, takes mere words, it takes written parts of Scripture, it takes ideas, and it has a way of even the simplest thing turning it and making it make sense into an experiential way. I have a love for the conceptual, and the Holy Spirit has this ability to take what's theory and conceptual and abstract and then form it and then utilize it. There's so many concepts in Scripture that you're like, I don't know how I would apply that. You're not supposed to think that necessarily, right? But the Bible is not necessarily how, when we read the Bible, it's not necessarily like, I need to know how to apply this in my life right now. There's application to things, but the first and foremost truth of the word is that abstract heavenly concepts somehow make it into us, and then we walk them out in this interesting experiential way. It's like mystery. When I first talked, I said that Christians are like mystical people. We are. We can know a lot of things, but the heart of Christianity is that we exist in the space of mystery. We exist in the space of, I walk into the church and I don't know how Holy Spirit is doing all of this. I don't know how being together makes me a better person all the time. I don't know how he takes an awesome baptism that we had a few weeks ago of water and turns that into a moment of complete transformation. We're so complex, and the Holy Spirit is so infinitely more complex, but he's able to take these abstract concepts and transform them that they make sense in our life, and all it requires us is to have belief. And this has actually been my heart as I watched people get baptized, and I watched things like communion, and I watched people come together, and even as I watched us in the Labor Day picnic, and I saw people together, and I saw people smiling, and I saw people being fed, and I saw like a community coming together. It's like, that's a supernatural thing. And how sad it is that Christians don't connect to it. You know, the traditions of the church are amazing. I love the traditions. I love that, you know, do you have to be baptized? To be saved, you have to be baptized. I don't think so. I don't think that's what it means. And yet Jesus is like, I want you to do it anyway. That communion, we're not from that same strain of Catholicism where we believe communion is your way, like your way into salvation, but he's like, take communion, right? We believe in that faith brings us into a place of salvation, but yet God then adds co into community. There's this nature about God that he's mysterious, and we as Christians are missing the point when we don't engage our belief. We don't engage that place of understanding that something supernatural is going on here. Part of our image as Christians in the image of God is that we're not just physical beings. We walk in here and supernatural things are going on. And the problem is, I talked a lot about materialism. I think materialism is one of the greatest evils in all the world, that there's like the belief that there's only this, that there's only physical reality. You know, it's one of the most evil things, and it's crept into the church, and it's made this weird anti-supernaturalism where we look at things as just actions, we look at things as just traditions, when no, those traditions are meant to engage, you're meant to engage in them, but you're meant to engage in them not just in a manner of seeing them physically, but you're supposed to engage in them believing that something is happening. When I'm eating the bread and I'm taking the wine and I'm remembering, I'm believing that Holy Spirit is doing something inside of me that I don't necessarily see, but I believe it. And when I see someone go under the water, I'm like, oh my God, this is amazing. This person is encountering, even if they don't recognize it in that moment, they're encountering the living God. And because of that, they're becoming greater than they could ever imagine. They're on a journey. Like, we have to return to certain elements of understanding that there's a mystery in the life we live. And when we don't connect with our belief, church is really boring. You know, church is not fun when we walk in here and it's like there's nothing happening. It's just me sitting here and the messages are really good, but messages like not connected to the Holy Spirit and engaging our spirits. And when we're not engaging our spirits, it's like I don't want to be here. You know, I likened like church traditions to this. If you have a healthy family system, holidays are amazing, right? The things you do on your birthday are amazing. The traditions you have as a healthy family unit are amazing, right? We used to have, whenever we had a birthday, we used to have like cinnamon buns in the morning. Sam still does. I need to get back into that. And when you have a healthy family system, you begin to enjoy those things. And though those things don't make you healthy, they're additions on to your experience, and you actually end up growing closer together because you have traditions, right? versus when you don't have a healthy family, you can have as many awesome, like as many Christmas dinners as you want, and you're not going to get any closer. The church is similar. We have awesome amounts of traditions, which one of the traditions is that we come together, like physical unity. Traditions that we have like communion, traditions that we have like baptism, tradition like praying for the sick. We have a lot of things that the Bible talks about, and these things are only as good if we decide to engage our spirits, which is what God calls belief. And we need, there's a lot of unbelieving Christians in church, and it's almost like I don't know what you missed in the first day of being a Christian. I don't know what you missed. In the sense that we're meant to believe in the things that are not seen. We're meant to believe in the things that we can't necessarily explain, but we're meant to take them on trust, and there has to be a trust in a relationship with God. When we read the scripture and it says that, you know, lay your hands on the sick, you know, and that they may be healed, what are we believing when we do that? What do we believe is happening? And this wasn't even what I was going to talk about, but I'm like, this is like a conviction I think for everyone, is that we have to enter into this building believing not only it's a holy place, believing not only that we're engaging with our brothers and sisters, believing not only that God wants to do something in the atmosphere, whether it's physical amazing manifestations or it's like subtle things, that he's doing something. And I talked to this about with my young adults, and I was like, there's something about when you understand that God's operating, even when you don't see it, you begin to notice it more. When you operate in belief, when you operate in believing that the supernatural is here and it's happening and it doesn't always look the same, but you know it's here, you begin to actually notice it. We were talking about our spiritual gifts, and I was like, when you begin to know how God called you to, like God made you, and how he operates through you, whether it's as simple as an act of service or it's the gift of prophecy, when you know that and you begin to operate in that, or you at least go and look for, and seek for places for that to come out, all of a sudden it's like, yeah, Holy Spirit's here, and he's here often. It's when we don't actively participate in what's going on in church, that's when we're like, man, I think I'm in a desert season. I don't think God's talking, you know? But when we actively come here and engage and look for where we can pour out ourselves in the way that God's called all of us to, Peter calls us all Levitical priests, and the Levitical priests were people that literally their worship, some of them their worship was carrying the tabernacle, picking up a specific amount of pieces and carrying it. And guess what they were doing? They were doing the work of the ministry in that place, and they all had these different awesome gifts. And then when they saw the cloud move, they moved. They were literally sometimes waiting on the Lord for the cloud to move. And that was their ministry. That was their act of worship. That was what they did. And Peter's like, you are that. You are that servant, priestly, Levitical line in this new covenant that God has created, which means every time you come to church, you're not only waiting on the Lord, you're seeking to what it is that I can bring, what it is that I can do. And I guarantee you, when that happens, it's like your mind explodes to how often you see Holy Spirit operating. When you don't seek and you don't hunger after it, it's like he's never there. All of a sudden, you decide that your heart's after seeking him and finding him. It's like crazy. You find him. Has anyone else ever experienced that? I'm engaging with that more and more, and even the simplest things of engaging with another Christian and talking, I have this belief that something is happening, and all of a sudden I start to see things happening. I start to see things turning, and it's mind-blowing sometimes, and it can be that simple. And this is not like a rebuke or anything, because this is what we're about. This is what spiritual maturity is about. This is what faith assembly is about. It's about getting you to recognize where Holy Spirit is, where he's been all along, and it turns out he's been here, and he's been doing things, and he's been maneuvering in the background. And I feel like our lives would become more robust if we stopped and looked to where he was and to what he's doing. The next quote I have is by a personal hero of mine, Nathan Finocchio. He says, "The Holy Spirit makes biblical realities consciously known. As the divine author of Scripture, he always seeks to make his words understood by the work of illumination. He reveals God through Scripture." I love this concept, the work of illumination. Illumination in Scripture is revelation, and God's like, it's like when you're in the dark and all of a sudden the light comes on. this fancy word called revelation that I think a lot of people talk about. It's when you're in the dark and all of a sudden light comes on. And what you couldn't see in the dark, you could see in the light. That's right? That's literally the simplicity of it. Revelation is what you couldn't see before the light came. Then the light came, and now you can see. This is the revelation and the beauty of our lives, and that I believe when we seek after Holy Spirit and recognize where he is, you will actually begin to see that more and more. The light will be turning on. The light in Scripture, if you want to understand Scripture right, like more, you have to seek where Holy Spirit, what Holy Spirit's doing through it. You have to invite him into the process. And he's more than willing to jump into that process. I have this quote, and it's, I think philosophy, proper philosophy helps us understand what God's doing. Philosophy is the ordering of the mind for the purpose of ordering the soul. Our thoughts set the framework of our physical and spiritual selves. God has a purpose. Thank you. Philosophy is the ordering and structuring of your mind after the image that God put in front of you. Ordering your mind so that then your soul can become ordered. There's a process to these things. When your mind is all over the place, your soul, it's bound to follow. When you put your mind upon heavenly things, when you put your mind into what God's done, not only in history, but what he's doing in this space, and you engage and you tune in to what he's doing, and you desire to seek the things that may be a little more obscure, maybe a little more subtle, your soul will begin to come into alignment. The healing of your soul comes out of the ordering of your mind, which means when things hurt, where is my mind? Is my mind on that hurt, or is my mind on, in the midst of this pain, Jesus is here, and though I don't feel better, Lord, I'd rather be here with you in the midst of my pain than be without you. This is what our hope is. Currently, our hope is that. I wish I could give you a better, like, more hopeful thing, like, if you're in the midst of pain, don't worry, God's going to get you out tomorrow. Man, I wish. No, that's not always the case. My advice would be is to engage your belief. If you're going through something hard, engage your belief that God said he'd be with you, that God said he'd be walk you through it. Though I rest in the valley of the shadow of death, I shall fear no evil. Read the Psalms, man. Read the Psalms daily. Be absorbed in the fact that there's pain and there's hurt, and yet the hope is that God's there. And I guarantee you, maybe you'll stop focusing on, man, I can't wait to be out of this, and maybe you'll begin to see what God wants you to get out of that situation, because there's always something he wants you to get out of that situation. And let's not waste time trying to get out of it, and maybe recognize that if the same situation is happening more than once, it's that he wants you to grab a hold of an eternal truth in the midst of a finite, painful experience. First Corinthians 13:11-13. When I was a child, I talked like a child, I thought like a child, I reasoned like a child. But when I became an adult, I set aside childish ways. For now we see in a mirror indirectly, but then we will see face to face. Spiritual maturity, man. I love the concept of having a heart of a child. This is why the Bible's so crazy. This is why God's so wild, and you need Holy Spirit to understand him, because at one point he's like, you know, you need to have the heart of a child. You need to have that where you come to me like a little child. And then then he raises up people like Paul, who's there to be like, listen, you were a child once, and now you're meant to be a man or a woman, a grown adult. You're meant to mature. And somehow those two realities coexist. Somehow the reality of me approaching faith like a child and then me operating like an adult mixed together perfectly. Somehow having my mind grown and tailored after the things of the Lord that walks me into maturity somehow partners perfectly with my heart to believe in the impossible, to believe in fairy tales, right? To believe in imaginations, to believe in a whole world that's not here. Somehow I can grow in my understanding of who God is, and that mirror can get clearer and clearer, and yet at the same time I can operate in mysterious truths that I don't understand how they work. Somehow, maturity in Christ means you grow younger at heart and you grow more wise in the mind. And they coexist. Now I know in part, but then I will know fully, just as I have been fully known. And now these three remain, faith, hope, and love, but the greatest of these is love. And I just love that, first of all, the concept of now we see in a mirror indirectly, but one day we'll see face to face. And there's the nature of reflection, right? And so right now, in our current finite experience, we see, I used to read different translations, and it used to be like you see through glass dimly, and it didn't make sense because, like, it's not the word, it's not the phrasing at all. It's actually talking about a mirror, and the mirrors back then were like bronze. They didn't have glass mirrors, you know? They were bronze. And the whole thing that Paul, I love, he's talking about maturing, and then he's like, by the way, your spiritual life, your finite spiritual life right now is as if you were looking in a glass that's not fully clear. But the hope is eventually you will see face to face. The hope is that the source that is the light that shines and gives you that image, that one day that will not just be the reflection of the sun or the reflection of the source of light on you reflecting, eventually there will be no separation and you will be in the midst of everything, like the fullness of the light. Even right now, we exist in a place where, you know, we could turn the lights off and then we don't have an image. We don't have light. And eventually, Paul is talking about the hope for all Christians is that we're going to exist in a space where there is no longer this sense of darkness. And whether that in heaven, that means actually no dark, or that means that the mirror will be fully clear, right? If light is the revealing of our image, then when we're with God face to face, then there's no more looking in a mirror indirectly. It'll be looking into the face of the image we were always meant to be. And that is our hope. I love what Isaiah 30:26 says. The light of the full moon will be like the sun's glare, and the sun's glare will be seven times brighter, like the light of 7 days, when the Lord binds up his people's fractured bones and heals them their severe wounds. And this is a beautiful part of Isaiah, and it's talking in the history of Israel and Judah. You know, the Assyrians are coming, and Judah's like, I don't know what we're going to do. We're literally facing down the barrel of a gun of this enemy army about to destroy us. And Isaiah spends the first part of that saying, look, you're going to want to look for other material ways of saving yourself, but they're all going to fail. We're looking for Egypt to save them. And he's like, they're all going to fail, right? But God's not going to fail. And this is what he says. He says, the light of the full moon will be like the sun's glare, and the sun's glare will be seven times brighter, like the light of 7 days. Seven's a beautiful number in biblical terms. It means completeness. Seven always comes back to the nature that God rested on the seventh day, because he rested because everything was complete. So the nature of the sun shining in Isaiah, the glare, that beautiful nature of the sun, is that it's going to be the completeness of God's light shining on you so that you can bear the fullness of the image you were always meant to bear. The fullness of the image of being created in God's image, it comes to bear in the fullness of who God is. And I love how that coincides with when the Lord binds up his people's fractured bones and heals their severe wounds. We already talked about Luke 11:33. No one, after lighting a lamp, puts it under a hidden place or under a basket, but on a lampstand, so that those who come in can see the light. Your eye is the lamp of your body. When your eye is healthy, your whole body is full of light. But when it is diseased, your body is full of darkness. Therefore, see it to it that the light in you is not darkened. If then your whole body is full of light, with no part in the dark, it will be as full of light as when the light of a lamp shines on you. That's what the Holy Spirit wants to do, guys. And we have a little bit of a part to play in that, meaning we don't allow our light to be darkened. Your image is incomplete without its reflection, and it is only as powerful as the source it draws from. Your image is incomplete without reflection. I think we've already discussed that even in spiritual terms and in physical terms. You don't have an image. No one can see you if there's no light. Spiritually, if there's no light of the source of heaven on you, that's what he's saying. That's the point he's making, is that you're in darkness and you have no image. It's only as powerful as the source it draws from. As created beings, our philosophy of image is directly tied to who or what we place as our source of light. Our personal image is our personal image is only ever a reflection of who we surrender to as supreme. Our heavens and earth are only as big as our God. Our existence is limited by our perception of the ultimate, which whether it be God or ourselves. So this is what I mean by the philosophy of image. We're either looking to God for our image or we're looking to ourselves for our image. And there's an amazing book called Orthodoxy by G.K. Chesterton. I love this book. And he makes the point saying, when your life, when the biggest part of your life is yourself, what a small life you live. When the biggest part of your life is God, how unlimited is your universe? He goes into the concept of saying that through materialism and anti-supernaturalism and believing we're the only thing here and there's nothing more in here, your world becomes from this, which is when you believe that there's, even in the very slightest, you believe that there is something greater than yourself, like that's the bare minimum. When you believe in that, your world is huge because you are not limited by what you know. You're limited by the vast unknown that could exist. When we live a life where our image is only ourselves and we look in that mirror and we only see ourselves, the ultimate limits of our life are ourselves, and it's like our world comes into this really small place. But the image is when my greatest source, which is how do you have a greatest source? It's what you surrender to. What you surrender to as ultimate in your life is the limit of your life. The unlimited nature of the Christian is supposed to be that I believe in a God that's unlimited, that's huge, that goes beyond my capacity, and because of that, I have the ability to believe in things that are more than myself. And having the image of God and being shined on by the source of who God is meant to encourage you to believe that there's an impossibility. There's an impossibility. There's a mysterious nature to the Christian's life that it's more than just me. I come into church believing that I'm operating in a sense that's more than just me. The hope of the Christian is that we are operating in a way that's more than just ourselves. We're not limited by ourselves, guys. I don't know who needs to hear that tonight, but you're not limited by yourself. I was coming up on the stage and I just heard God say, don't be limited by yourself. Walk with me up here. Walk with me in what you got to do in life. Walk with me through any place of pain or grief, and then you'll begin to see that the possibilities are mind-blowing. And the problem with immature Christianity, the problem with immaturity is that we look at ourselves and we're very self-centered. You can even see that in little kids. The reason why they're probably so immature is because they can really only focus on themselves. Same thing with you, older adults. Same thing with Christians. When we only focus on ourselves and we don't focus on the bigness of God and surrender to the bigness of God's will, his plan, his truth, we almost immediately become the gods of our own universe, and we begin to follow after our own authority. And when we do that, we are literally, our entire universe is like made in our image. And I want to end with this one thing, and I want to pray over us. I'm sorry if that was a little disjointed, but I fully believe Holy Spirit wants to speak to us through it. And so G.K. Chesterton says this, "So you are the creator and redeemer of the world, but what a small world it must be. What a little heaven you must inhabit, with angels no bigger than butterflies. How sad it must be to be God, and an inadequate God. Is there really no life fuller and no love more marvelous than yours? And is it really in your small and painful pity that all flesh must put its faith? How much happier you would be, how much more of you there would be, if the hammer of a higher God could smash your small cosmos, scattering the lights like spangles and leaving you in the open, free like other men, to look up as well as down." And what he's talking about is the nature that when we lay down our authority, when we lay down our self-centered image, we open up the door to possibilities. And when we lay down our own authority and put up the authority of God, it's almost like a higher reality comes and smashes our smallness and opens up the door for us to not only look at the world with wonder and the mystery of the unknown, but it also allows us to trust in something that's far bigger than ourselves. And that was the full point of what I wanted to talk about tonight, is that there's opportunity tonight, and the worship team could come up as well. There's an opportunity tonight for us to lay down the limitedness of ourselves. There's an opportunity tonight to take hold of the unlimitedness of God in every situation. And I believe Holy Spirit's connecting the concept of walking through grief, walking through pain, walking through our finite nature, and recognizing that God actually wants to do something, and it's going to cause us to lessen our reliance on ourselves and to take hold of a further reliance on God. I fully believe that's what he wants to do in this season as we're growing, the season as faith is growing and we're building community and we're walking in new territory. I think the world's changing vastly and Christianity is walking through it. And the only way we're going to get through that is if we're determined to not trust in ourselves as the one way to walk through it, but we're determined to trust in a higher source that is God. And so I want to pray over us, and I want us to take this place an opportunity. If there's any place where we've put ourselves above God in our lives, any place where our image has superseded the image of God, and we have not allowed that light to shine and reflect that eternal truth, and we found ourselves relying on what we can do, relying on who we could be. And I believe that the impossible begins to happen when we open up the horizons of our own understanding, when we open up the horizons of our own belief system, and we rely on something that's far greater than ourselves. I had this quote, I believe entering the rest of God is having a trust that there's something substantial not only holding you, but supporting you. If you want to enter into the rest of God, it requires you to trust that in every situation of your life, you have something far stronger supporting you. And I don't know in here, does anyone feel unsupported in their life? And you don't have to raise your hand, but I feel like one of the biggest lies of the enemy is that we begin to feel unsupported in our life, and we begin to feel like everything's on us. And we begin to feel like our shoulders are growing really heavy with the weight of everything we're dealing with, whether it's our family. You know, one of the biggest things is people feel responsible for their family, whether it's for our own future. I know for young people, that was the biggest thing. If you're responsible for getting everything in your future correct, whether it's your relationships, if there's anyone in here that is like contending for a relationship, that rest comes and operating out of rest comes when you're deciding to trust that something else has the weight of those things more than your own shoulders. And what we begin to realize is that our body begins to react the same way our souls react. So if your soul feels overwhelmed by the weight of the world, your body most likely begins to feel that too. If there's anyone in here with any shoulder back things, I want to pray over that. I want to pray that God releases every physical ailment and every spiritual ailment. And that comes with a deeper sense of trust. So, I would love if anyone who's here, our prayer leaders, whether it's Pastor Sam or Pastor Jeff or whoever, could come up here. And I want to open up the altars as we worship. I want to open up the altars for anyone who feels overwhelmed. If anyone who feels like they have the weight of the world on their shoulders, if anyone feels like they have an issue of belief and they have a hard time believing in the supernatural, they have a hard time believing in the impossible. And if there's anyone in here that just needs prayer to walk through a hard time, if there's any grief in here, I believe that imparting and laying hands can begin to open a door for you to see where God is in that, because he wants to do something amazing. so we're just going to be down here, and as we enter into worship, if there's any of those things, man, come up and get prayer, and believe that as you come up and get prayer and hands are laid on you, that something crazy or supernatural or powerful is happening, that God wants to be with you in that moment and in that space. I love you guys. I genuinely love you guys a lot, and I thank you for, you know, opening up your Wednesday just to hear me and to see what God wants to say, and I don't take it for granted at all, and I'm really happy to be a part of this community, and I think we're doing amazing things, and we're going to go amazing places. So, Jesus, I thank you for tonight, God. Thank you for what you're doing. Let your spirit of freedom be in this space, and as we just worship and enter into the holy ground that is your altar, the holy space that is your house, Lord Jesus, that freedom would reign true in this space, that freedom and grace would reign true, and that these things would not be words, these things would not be just written words, that they would become realities, and that the shining, the illumination of your light, Lord God, seven times, Lord Jesus, the complete illumination of your life would flow into every individual that needs it. God, you're so good, and as we wait on you, as we stand with you, God, that you would reveal yourself truer and truer. We love you, Lord. In Jesus' name.